So good evening, everyone. Happy to see you here, and I'm extremely happy, delighted to have with us Professor Kesavan Veluthat. Many people in this room know him and his work. Yigal Broner will introduce him in just a moment. I just want to say that Kesavan Veluthat I think, the outstanding historian of South India, in pre-modern South India in our generation. It's an honor to have him with us. Aside from that, he's also a very close and dear friend. And so welcome to Kesavan. And Yigal Broner, I'd like to ask you to introduce him.
Thank you, David, and thank you, everyone, for coming. Professor Kesavan Veluthat is one of the, possibly the most important historian today of South India, pre-modern South India, and with a specific interest in the history of Kerala. He is the student of MGS Narayanan, who is basically the founder of modern historical studies of South India and of Kerala. He taught at various prestigious universities, first in Kerala, then at Mangalore University. Then when he retired for several years, he taught at Delhi University. Now he's teaching at Hyderabad University. And he published dozens of books. I'll mention just a few of them: The Political Structure of Early Medieval South India in 2012, The Early Medieval in South India 2008, Kerala Throughout the Ages with MGS Narayanan, his teacher. Professor Veluthat has brought up a whole generation of important students who are really the future of the study of the historical study of South India, students with a lot of imagination and interest like himself. And so I can go on and on, but instead I want to tell you a story that I heard from Professor Veluthat himself. When he was about to begin his studies, And this story is related to another fact that many of his books are actually not just about history, but also about literature and literary history. So when he was about to begin his studies, he actually wanted to study literature and not history. And when he was basically in line to get his forms in for registering for BA studies in history, one of his
In literature,
yeah. The professor there asked him, "What are you doing?" And he said, "Oh, I want to study literature." And he said, "No. You can't do that. This is the surest way to hate literature if you study literature." So this is how we earned both a lover of history and a lover of literature in one person, in Professor Veluthat. And a person who is a true humanist with great curiosity and great vision, who reads everything and can say something interesting about everything, as you will now see. So please welcome Professor Kesavan Veluthat.
So, Professor Schulman, Professor Broner, esteemed colleagues and dear friends. I'm extremely grateful to the Israel Academy of Sciences and Humanities for this singular honor it has done me by asking me to give a talk from this distinguished platform, knowing fully well that my shoulders are too weak to carry this honor. I seek your indulgence in discussing a problem that I have been concerned with for some time now. I'm basically a student of regional history in India, and my admittedly meager reading and research have so far been about the history of Kerala on the southwestern part of the Indian subcontinent, with an occasional foray into the neighboring Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. Therefore, I presume to take up a central question in regional history in this talk, which is related to the constitution of the region through the ages. Here the question, namely, what exactly do we mean by region, will come up again. The usual lexical gloss that, I quote, a region is any space that is distinct from another area, and that it is from the Latin expression regionum, which means direction, boundary, district, etc., comes to mind. A region is therefore thought of as a constituent part of a larger whole. In speaking about regions as constituting larger geographical entities, one has to recognize that even the parts vary in their features, size, boundary, constituents, and so on. To take the example of my own home state in India, namely Kerala, we can raise the question as to what is the validity of this unit for purposes of historical studies. An attempt to answer this question can be made in two ways. One can try and find out the forces that went into defining a region with clearly identifiable constituents and equally clear causalities working towards it. A second way is to examine the way in which historians tried to constitute the region from time to time as a discursive formation. I presume to take up both these aspects in this talk. I do it with a clear understanding that it is hard to differentiate the two, that is, history and historiography. It is increasingly recognized that to distinguish history and historiography is well nigh impossible. To be sure, early sources do not use the term Kerala to denote the land that goes by that name. The term Chera, Cheraman, occurs in the early Tamil literature in the sense of a lineage of chiefs. The Prakrit Sanskrit equivalent or corruption of the term Cheraman, namely Ketalaputa, Keralaputra, figures in the edicts of Ashoka. The Greco-Roman accounts of the early centuries of the Christian era use a Greek variant, Kelobothros, Kerobothros. Many places in the Malayalam-speaking region of today figure in the copious literature in Tamil produced in this period, and many lineages of that region are mentioned in this literature. But there is no notion of Kerala as a geographical unit. Tamilagam, the land south of Venkatam, north of Kumari, and bounded by seas on either side, was their homeland, which subsumed the present-day Kerala of Kerala, present-day region of Kerala, as its integral part. Nor does the Malayalam language or even a mention of it figure in any of the sources of this period. There are occasional references to variations in the linguistic usage described as characteristics of Malay Nadu, the hill country, Malay Nadu Varakam, the usage of the hill country, a purely geographical name by which the land west of the Western Ghats was known. Even these references are of a much later date, occurring in the medieval commentaries to the early Tamil anthologies, suggesting that they were not aberrations for the contemporaries. The earliest definitive reference to Kerala as a separate geographical entity and made by that name is arguably in the Avanti Sundari Katha of Dandin. The author, the 8th century Sanskrit poet from the Pallava capital in Kanchi, speaks of his friends, including Matradatta, the best of Brahmanas from Kerala. Mitrani Matradattadya, Keraleshu Divyotama. In the same century or early in the next, Shaktibhadra, a dramatist from Kerala, composed Ascharya Chudamani, a Sanskrit play. He does not, however, refer to Kerala by name, a junior contemporary of Shaktibhadra does it, almost with a vengeance. He was Kulashekhara Varman, a 9th century king of Kerala, identified with Sthanuravi Kulashekhara, who ruled in the second half of the 9th century. He describes himself as Kerala Kula Chudamani and Kerala Adhinatha in the Sanskrit plays, the former being a reference to the Kerala lineage and the latter an unmistakable reference to the Kerala country of which he was the ruler, Kerala Adhinatha. In fact, he calls himself Mahodayapura Parameshwara and Kerala Adhinatha. In any case, a slightly later text clarifies that the king of Mahodayapuram protected the Kerala Vishayam Palikyanai, the land of Kerala. A commentary of the plays composed during the playwright's lifetime describes the author as Kerala Vishaya Adhipa, that is, the overlord of the territory of Kerala. In short, Kerala gets defined as a chronological geographical unit, the territory of a particular political unit with definite boundaries and a capital city by the time we come to the end of the 9th century. Interestingly, we start getting reference to Kerala as a separate political unit in the records of the Chalukyas, Pallavas, and Pandyas a little earlier, and of the Cholas by the time of these plays. Whether the early references in the Pallava Chalukya documents are to the lineage of the Cheras or the country of Kerala, the later ones in the Chola records are certainly to the Kerala country. It is significant that these references are coeval with and take cognizance of the emergence of the state in what is now Kerala, that is, the Chera kingdom of Mahodayapuram or Magodai, that starts showing itself in the records, at least from the beginning of the 9th century. Sorry. This kingdom is to be distinguished from the chiefdom of the Cheras of an earlier period, evidence of which is available in the ancient Tamil poetry. The territory of this newly formed state composed the entire area covered by the modern linguistic state of Kerala. Inscriptions from this period, discovered from the entire length of Kerala, bear the stamp of a single socio-political unit, which was presided over by the Chera Perumal. The same language and script are used in these records, which are dated in the regnal years of the Chera Perumal, or else followed some other means of dating. Conventions accepted all over the area emerged, and so did some kind of uniformity in the matter of organization and functioning of the agrarian corporations of the Brahmanical groups. It is also significant that this identity and uniformity were defined in contradistinction with what was obtaining in the Tulu-speaking regions of the north and the Tamil-speaking regions of the east. One of the factors responsible for the formation of the state and the particular character it had as distinct from the rest of South India was the rise of the Brahmanical groups in Kerala and settlements in the river valleys. The majority of these took shape only in the period of the transition from the early historical to the early medieval. These were somewhat unique in ways more than one. The Brahmanas of Kerala cherished the Parashurama tradition, that the land was created by Parashurama and that the land was gifted to them by Parashurama, something which they shared with their counterparts in the rest of the west coast, all the way up to Gujarat in north, but distinct from those of the other parts of the peninsula. For example, in Tamil Nadu or the rest of Karnataka, you don't have this tradition of Parashurama creating the land and gifting it to Brahmanas. They developed a number of unusual practices in Kerala known as anacharas, and these distinguished the Brahmanas of Kerala from those of the rest of India. There was a difference in the pattern of settlements, which was a function of the physiography and ecology of the region. In any case, the Brahmanical settlements of Kerala developed features that were entirely different from their counterparts in other parts of the peninsula. This Brahmanical character with the Parashurama stamp can be seen from the statement in 11th century Chola record, the Thiruvalangad copper plate, describing Kerala as, I quote, "the incomparable land dear to good people and created by Rama, who takes delight in exterminating the Kshatriyas. Sarva Kshatra Vatha Vrata Pradayina Ramena Yannirmitam Rashtram." At the same time, they also shared with the rest of South India, or perhaps the entire country, many common features of what was laid down in the Dharmashastra texts in the matter of their community organization, even when the Dharmashastras were flouted with impunity in the matter of many of the anacharas as well as other practices. The introduction of the Brahmanical element with the Parashurama tradition seems to be the starting point of the distinctiveness of Kerala and its departure from the rest of Tamil. The Brahmanical claim that it was Parashurama who created their land and donated it to them is seen all over the western seaboard in India. In the case of the south, it is the strip of land from Gokarna to Kanyakumari which is identified as the land retrieved by Parashurama. Gradually, even this unit disintegrates as the land between Perumbura and Kanyakumari is defined as actually the Malanad or Parashurama Kshetra. This newly defined unit was earlier a part of Tamilagam, but this affiliation is swept below the carpet in the changed context. The historical tradition of this new formation does not cherish details concerning the earlier Chera rulers and their exploits contained in early Tamil songs such as Padithruppattu anymore. For instance, a Malayalam narrative called Keralolpatti, concerned with the history of Kerala, is totally silent about this aspect of the past. The contents of this narrative date from this period, although the date of its composition itself is problematic. One feature which distinguished the new formation was its religion, a putative religion. The cults and practices of the earlier period aimed at the propitiation of the folk deities in the Trinais in the Tamil literature gave way to the worship of the Agamaic deities like Shiva and Vishnu, consecrated in temples. The Brahmanical element had a not insignificant role to play in this, for all the Brahmanical settlements, which functioned as agrarian corporations controlling vast estates of land, were centered on these temples. The native population was brought within their magnetic field and provided the necessary claims for the hegemonic elements to command the acquiescence of the hegemonized. Taking place in the period of the celebrated Bhakti movement in South India, of which at least two leaders were Chera rulers themselves, this religious transformation was very crucial for the realignment of identities as well. Deities worshipped by the people were part of the larger pan-Indian tradition from now on, and all the traditions of the epics and Puranas in Sanskrit became part of the heritage of anybody who identified himself with this new religion. Sanskrit was getting precedence over Tamil. The fact that literary productions of the early leaders of the Bhakti movement from Kerala were in Tamil notwithstanding. To be considered along with this religion if not as part of it, is caste. It is here that Kerala presents its distinctiveness in the clearest manner. Interestingly, the text that I referred to, that is Kerala Utpatti, has a whole section giving details about the innumerable castes and the relative status each had, defining the norms of purity and pollution and attributing the entire system to the inevitable Shankaracharya. The heavy Sanskritic nature of the ideas and institutions obtaining in this newly emerged political cultural unit is obvious. Prescriptions of the Dharmashastras are followed in matters of social conduct and statecraft. In fact, even in laying down the details of the organization of an urban center under the Christian church at Kurakkani Kollam, the model of the Arthashastra is followed. In cultural matters, the repertoire of the Sanskrit epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata, is used heavily as the earliest dramas, such as Ascharya Chudamani, Subhadra Dhananjaya, and Tapatifthambharana would show. The temple theatre, which had its beginning in this period, used these and other Sanskrit plays with their epic contents. Sculpture and painting drew liberally on this repertoire. Arrangements for the propagation of epics were made through specialists such as the Mahabharata Bhattas, who expounded the epic in temples, and there is no evidence of the use of the Tamil tradition. A comparison of the popularity of the Sanskrit works of Kulasekhara Varman and the Tamil hymns of the author in Kerala in this and later periods will eminently prove this point. So also, themes from the equally rich treasure available in Tamil are not used by authors in Kerala for their compositions in Sanskrit. Even the first literary works in Malayalam are Ramacharita and a translation of the Arthashastra, both dated to about the 12th century. When more works were composed, the themes were either taken from the storehouse in Sanskrit epics and other literary treasure or invented de novo. Thus, the identity of Kerala that was crafted in the age of the Cheraman Perumals was clearly an upper caste, Brahmanical, Sanskritic nature. It is this historical baggage of unity and identity that Kerala carried with it in the subsequent periods, in spite of the heavy fragmentation which polity experienced. Kerala was still referred to as Cheraman Nadu, the land of Cheramans, in the literature of the post-Chera period. The ghost of the Perumal haunted the land in many ways. Mahodayapuram, that is somewhere in this region. is still represented as the town from which the land of Cheramans was ruled, a town of cultivated gentlemen and comely ladies, an epitome of civilized life. A copperplate record dated a century after the disappearance of the Chera kingdom suggests a pan-Kerala appeal that the town had. It speaks, perhaps wishfully, of the endorsement that the important political divisions and social units had made on the grant recorded in it. Each of the large number of principalities that came into existence on the ruins of the Chera kingdom claimed to be not only a splinter of the old kingdom, but also deriving its authority from the donation of the last Cheraman Perumal. Thus, Venad in the south and Kolathunad in the north and all other kingdoms in between participated in the same historical tradition and shared the same identity. Many of these rulers also claimed to step into the shoes of the Perumal in claiming to be the overlord of Kerala. Thus, the ruler of Venad or Zamorin or Raja of Cochin staked this claim in various ways. The strong Brahmanical character in the earlier power structure is not seen in most of the successor states anymore, but the cultural identity of Kerala, which had been forged in the earlier period of Brahmanical hegemony, continued. Onam, which began as a Vaishnava sectarian festival with a strong Tamil background, gets entirely Malayalamized. All this would show that the clearly defined identity that Kerala had acquired in the Perumal era continued in nearly every detail. In fact, this period looked upon itself as a continuation from the earlier period, whereas the earlier one did not have any such pretensions. These differences and the factors behind it are a matter recognized by the authors of this period. For instance, a medieval Manipravalam text of the 14th century speaks of the speciality of the land on account of its fertility, also a gift of Parashurama. The rainy season, I quote from that, the rainy season under the orders of Parashurama comes here frequently like a mother coming to breastfeed her children. Shukha Sandesha, a work in Sanskrit, puts the same thing slightly differently. The poet introduces the land and land of Kerala across the Western Ghats. I quote, "Now you see the Brahmakshatra land, which testifies to the might of Parashurama's arms. This country, rich in pepper and vines, growing on tall coconut and erica palms, is what is celebrated as Kerala." The distinctness of Kerala, these texts believe, was a function of its geography and climate. It is at this point that one sees a conscious attempt at constituting Kerala and its language, creating a self-image, as it were. M.R. Raghava Warrior has made a brilliant analysis of a medieval text, Leeladilaga, a manual of the grammar, prosody, and poetics of Manipravalam, the union of Bhasha and Sanskrit, where Bhasha stands for Malayalam. The language of this text itself is Sanskrit, not Malayalam. This or any other contemporary text from Kerala does not call Malayalam by that name, it being used for the first time outside Kerala, as in the 15th century Telugu work, the Sri Bhimeshwara Puranamu of Srinatha. Curiously, another term that Leeladilagam uses to denote the language of Kerala is Tamil, but the anonymous author hastens to explain that this Tamil is different from the language in the Chola country, etc. A very detailed discussion bordering on the polemic follows in an attempt to demonstrate the distinctiveness of Kerala Bhasha as opposed to other languages of South India. So also, the same text shows that Kerala had acquired the necessary self-confidence to ridicule languages, people, and institutions outside Kerala as inferior. Now we go to the historiographical discourse. The historiographical discourse constituting Kerala as a separate region with its own identity begins with the text called Keralotpatti, which I was talking about. This is about the origin of Kerala. The date of its composition itself is problematic. This text is crucial as arguably the first attempt to historicize Kerala as a separate unit with its own defined territory and peculiar institutions. It opens by giving an account of Parashurama's creation of Kerala, the land between Gokarna and Kanyakumari, by claiming it from the Arabian Sea with a fling of his axe and settling it with Brahmanas brought from the north in 64 gramas, of which 32 were in Tamil Nadu and the remaining in present-day Kerala. The first thing we notice is the definition of territory, 160 kathams of land between Gokarna and Kanyakumari. Even here, the text is nuanced further. While the whole stretch of Kerala, the land from Gokarna to Perumbura in Tulunadu, and the land between Perumbura and Kanyakumari is Malanad. Speaking about the way in which Parashurama peopled the land of Kerala after raising it from the sea, the Keralalpati says that the Brahmanas, who were brought and settled in the first instance, would not stay. They returned to their original home in Ahichatra for fear of serpents in the new land. Parashurama brought a second wave of Brahmanas again from Ahichatra. In order that they would not be accepted back home if they returned, he enjoined that they sport a frontal tuft of hair and wear only white clothes. Thus the people of Kerala are shown as distinct from the rest of the country with their own hairstyle and dress code. He also persuaded them to accept the mother right so that he could expiate for his own matricidal sin. Patterns of descent and inheritance too distinguish the people of Kerala. Parashurama also established 108 temples for Shiva, Shasta, and Durga. The difference between the situations in Kerala and the land immediately to the north is crucial in this regard. Both are described as the creation and donation of Parashurama. But the major factor behind this, apparently, the role of the Brahmanical groups in the two societies. The landed wealth in South Canara was not under the control of the Brahmanical groups as much as it was in Kerala. And therefore, the importance that the Brahmanas of Kerala had in polity and society was not matched by what their counterparts in South Canara had. As it was much greater in the case of Kerala, Parashurama is invoked as not only the creator of the land, but also the donor of the Brahmana groups, the latter being not the case in South Canara. So also the exceptional importance attached to the arms-bearing Brahmanas is another instance of the use of the past in seeking validation of Brahmanical groups. If these are the geographical, ethnographical, and cultural constituents of Kerala, according to Keralalpati, the political historical constituent too is clearly defined there in an unequivocal manner. Representatives of the Brahmanical establishment governed the land gifted to them by Parashurama as Brahmakshatra. In the course of time, however, they realized that the business of administration corrupted them, and they themselves decided to get a Kshatriya as their ruler. Accordingly, a Kshatriya and his sister were brought. The brother was anointed king and was made to swear habitual allegiance to them. A monarchical state was established in Kerala. The sister was married to a Brahmana, and it was agreed that the progeny would belong to the Kshatriya caste according to the matrilineal system. The descendants of this sister would be the successors to the throne. The conviction that government was not the Brahmana's cup of tea and that it belonged to the Kshatriya is very much in tune with the Brahmanical principles and the theory of Varnashrama Dharma, and the upper caste Brahmanical character of it is hard to miss, both in the narrative and in other Brahmanical other contemporary records. At the same time, there is no attempt to latch the origin of the dynasty on either to one of the reputed lineages such as the Suryavamsa or Chandravamsa, or to those celebrated in the Tamil tradition, nor is an origin myth in the tradition typical of the medieval court literature in Sanskrit invented, or the heroic deeds of the ruler of this ancestors recited. All this would show that Kerala had arrived as a separate political entity and that Keralalpati was trying to historicize it. At this point, contextualizing this portion of the narrative will be in order. The history of the Chera kingdom of Mahodayapuram is now fairly clearly known. A close examination of Keralalpati shows that it is the first historical portion is an attempt to historicize this kingdom. Sources describing the territory which it presided by the name Kerala for the first time. As mentioned above, The word Kerala does not occur in the sources in the sense of a territory. Only his early references as to the lineage of the Cheras, known to early Tamil sources as Cheral, Kerala being a Prakrit Sanskrit form of this expression. In fact, even after Kerala came to be used as the name of a land following the establishment of the Chera kingdom, the alternative expression for Kerala Vishaya was Cheramannad, the land of the Cheras, which clearly proves this point. The post-Chera narrative, historicizing the political entity, is conscious of the identity of the region which it crafts. This is demonstrated by the fact that even the social divisions of Kerala that it speaks about have a character distinct from the rest of the country. It speaks about the temples of Shiva, Durga, and Shasta that Parashurama had consecrated in the land. Moreover, the most authentic thing of Kerala is its peculiar system of caste with its own norms of purity and pollution. Certain castes are considered as so low that the approach and even the very sight of their members is thought to be polluting. In fact, the Keralalpatti is very elaborate in its treatment of these jatis in Kerala. Interestingly, the text attributes the ordering of these caste system in Kerala to the ubiquitous Shankaracharya, a means of achieving legitimacy for the institution, notwithstanding the contradiction involved in it. After Kerala was so constituted historiographically, we see that this entity, with its new identity, had acquired the necessary self-confidence in the post-era period. Kerala Bhasha, or the language of Kerala, had come of age, although the word Malayalam does not figure from the documents in this region. In any case, Malayalam had arrived as a distinct language with its own vocabulary, grammar, syntax, and morphology. What is more, Iladilagam, which announces this arrival, was composed in the 14th century. The self-confidence that Kerala exudes in that text is so much that it looks upon others, such as the Tuluvas and the Tamils, as so many inferiors. This derives from the literary expressions and practices where Kerala is represented as the best land. All this is seen as following the experience in the Chera kingdom. At a different level, however, there was another statement which formed part of the discursive formation, constituting the same region considerably differently. That was the identity of Malabar, and it was particularly a subject of the Arab and later European traders. It had the same geographical reach as Malanad or Kerala or Keralalpatti. One such statement, articulating a clear consciousness of this Malabar, is an Arabic text by Sheikh Sainuddin, written primarily as a call for a holy war against the Portuguese. The full title of the work is suggestive. I translate that: a tribute to the holy warriors in respect of a brief account of the Portuguese. Its primary purpose is to give a call for jihad or holy war against the perpetrators of atrocity against Muslims, but it presents a short history of Islam in Malabar and also describes a few strange, detestable, within quotes, customs of the people of Malabar. It articulates the consciousness regarding Malabar with not only a characterization of its internal socio-political features, but also a clear definition of its boundaries. Accordingly, Malabar is the whole country with Kumari as its boundary in the south and Kanjirakot, that is Kasaragod, in the north, more or less the same territory that you have here from Kasaragod to Kanyakumari. Places like Calicut, Veliyangod, Tiruvarangadi, Thanur, Ponnani, Paravanna, the localities surrounding Chariyam, Kakkad, Tiruvangad, Mahi, and so on, are described as thickly populated and grew into towns with thriving trade and commerce, all because of Muslims. The Malabar that the Sheikh constitutes is one centered on Muslim trading groups. The other inhabitants of the land are described, as also their customs, in great detail with a view to defining this land authentically. This description also enables the identification of the Muslim groups with a special with the local population. They are not mentioned as the oppositional other in any attempt to constitute the self. The antagonistic elements there are the Portuguese, no swear word being spared in describing them. Thus we have a Malabar from Kasaragod to Kanyakumari, like from Perumbula again, Kasaragod to Kanyakumari in the Brahmanical statements. In this Arabic text, which is synonymous with the Kerala of other sources and which represented how the Muslim scholar wanted to constitute it. In this context, the way in which the Portuguese saw Malabar will be interesting. One of the most detailed and extremely authentic accounts of the Malabar coast is contained in the book of Duarte Barbosa. Barbosa had acquired considerable familiarity with the land he was describing, and he had cultivated the language, I quote, so well that he spoke it better than the natives of the country, unquote. According to Barbosa, the land of Malabar begins from a place called Kumbla, near Kasaragod. Further north of Kasaragod, you can see a place called Kumbla. And in all, from the hill of Delhi and ending at the Cape Comorin, that is Kanyakumari, and it is 130 leagues along the coast. Barbosa repeats the tradition of the rule of Cheraman Perumal and shows how the constitution of Kerala through that kind of historiography has been achieved in this case also. He knew that, I quote, in this land of Malabar, all men use one tongue only, which they call Malayalam. Barbosa too, like Sheikh Sainuddin, gives a detailed account of the different castes of the inhabitants of Malabar and demonstrates that a region is not just a geographical expression. It is constituted by people who speak one language, share in common cultural traditions, and distinguish themselves with others. The description of the castes in Kerala, both indigenous and foreign, is so vivid that it is clear that he knew who was in it and who was off it. The customs of both the natives and the sojourners are described not as detestable as in the case of the descriptions of the Sheikh. If there is less than accommodation shown to any community, it is to the Muslims, and that too on a scale much smaller than the way in which the Muslim scholar represents the Portuguese. The difference between the Muslim perception and the Portuguese perception is brought out clearly by a comparison between the senses belonging that the Sheikh shows and the Portuguese writer does not show. For Tawfiqul Mujahideen, Malabar was a land of Muslims. The people of Malabar had accepted Islam willingly. Even when the strange and detestable customs of Malabar are described, what informs such descriptions is a curiosity and eagerness to report the exotic. The land of Malabar was theirs, and they had to protect it, waging a jihad against the accursed Portuguese. On the other hand, the Portuguese writer does not have any such commitment. He just describes the land which he was very familiar with. Even when he does not make a secret of his dislike to the Muslims, he does not take up any commitment of cleansing the land of them. In other words, he had not made the land his own, whereas the Muslim scholar had. At the same time, the eagerness to participate in a tradition of a larger whole, that is, when you are talking about a region, it is supposed to be part of a larger whole. Larger whole can be seen too. At one level, it was the attempt to affiliate this region to a larger unit of civilization, depending on the point of view of the agency of imagination. Identifying Kerala as a Janapada in Bharatavarsha can be seen from the period of the Puranas. but that is as vague as it is inconsequential. The attempt to achieve a parentation to the larger unit from this side can be seen again in the Keralotpatti. One of the recensions from Kerala, Koyalathunad, that is, from the north, has a pretentious beginning with a claim to narrate Jambudvipolpatti, that is, the rise of the Rose Apple Island, that is, India. Kerala is clearly situated within the geographical horizon familiar to the Puranic world, and its origin naturally is part of the origin of Jambudvipa. This attempt in a narrative that seeks to constitute Kerala is extremely significant, but it goes beyond such technical texts. One of the medieval Manipravalam texts, Chandrolsavam, has a verse which seeks to participate in this tradition and includes Kerala within the geographical locus. It says that there are 8 other khandas around and that the southern one of Bharata is more charming than them. Even within it, the land of Cheramans is like the auspicious mark on the forehead of the goddess of prosperity and the god of love. By the time we come to 16th century, this identity is taken for granted. The idea of Bharata or Bharatavarsha, which evolved through the centuries in the expressions of the high culture of India, particularly in the period of and after the Guptas, was something which Kerala had came to know about the age of the Cheraman Perumals. To begin with, Tamilagam, of which present-day Kerala was an inseparable part, did not have much consciousness of this idea. The copious literature of Tamil, although containing stray influences of the Vedic Shastraic Puranic elements, does not participate in this kind of a geographical tradition. It was only in the age of transition from the early historical to the early medieval that this kind of an affiliation had taken place. Gradually, however, Kerala began to participate in the common traditions of this larger unit of Bharata as an affiliate. The post-Perumal era in Kerala thus found itself as an integral part of Bharatavarsha, and it was the Brahminical agency which achieved it. The land created by Parashurama was already part of the land of Bharata. In the case of Sheikh Sainuddin, however, we see that he looks at Malabar as part of an Islamic cosmopolis, Darul Islam. In fact, the Sheikh is convinced that it was to the Muslim rulers of the world that appeals had to be sent out for help when this Darul Islam was under threat. It was such Muslim rulers as the Sultan of Jazarat, that is Gujarat, the Adil Shahi Sultan of Deccan, the Sultan of Misr, that is Egypt, the Sultan of Turkey, and so on, who were appealed and variously helped and refused to help. This is obviously an Islamic commonwealth, nothing specially about Indian about it. No wonder he dedicates the book not to this Amorin, king of Calicut, of whom he speaks so kindly and with the highest respect, but to the Sultan of Bijapur, far afield, Sultan Ali Adil Shah, I quote, "The noblest and most respected of all rulers, one who takes delight in the struggle against disbelievers and regards fighting to uphold the divine word as a great honor. He sets his mind towards the service of the servants of Allah. This lofty courage disposes him to destroy the enemies of Allah," unquote. In the case of Barbosa, there is no such attempt to affiliate the land of Malabar to any larger whole such as the Christendom. Even the later attempts of the Portuguese in the Synod of Diamper was only to make the Christians of Malabar part of the Roman Catholic Church, not the whole of Malabar itself. That is another story. Because of this somewhat long infliction is to show how a particular region in the Indian subcontinent was constituted historically, historiographically. We have seen that a particular region gets defined on account of the working of different forces at the levels of economy, society and polity at certain points in time, with a consciousness and identity of its own. This identity is defined in two ways, A, in its own terms, and B, in contradistinction with the others. The next step is an attempt to seek validation to this. This is done largely with an appeal to history, that is, by invoking a particularly manufactured image of its past. The account varied each time, depending upon the agency which articulated the account and the purpose for which it was articulated. However, that the three different statements which went into the making of the discursive formation more or less agreed with one another, despite the totally different moorings of each, shows the strength of the discourse that had been created as a result. The reason is simple. It had the backing of historical factors. An identity that was crafted under the Chera kingdom was represented in the first of these statements. Even while that identity continued, new elements that were introduced both carried forward and changed the identity and affiliation. I beg to submit that the process of the formation and articulation of identity and its later historicization offers an interesting case study in the larger process of identities and affiliations. Objective conditions, including the geography and ecology, have a not insignificant role in these. Economic, social, and political factors are of an equally important significance in the process. Historical and cultural factors too come to the stage and contribute their share. Attempts to explain it take recourse to history. Once the identity of a unit is thus congealed and articulated, there are attempts to affiliate that unit to larger units. These affiliations depended on the interests of the groups which sought such affiliation. It is hoped that such patterns will be helpful in delineating the processes obtaining elsewhere and thus clearing many cobwebs which vitiate our understanding of what we are and how we are related to others. Thank you.
Thank you, Kesavan. We can take a few minutes if there are questions. Please.
Yeah. Thank you very much for us to know about the history of the Jewish and those churches with the Aramaic script and how those communities actually were formed and what happened to them in the end. I know that some of the Jewish community are right here, but what happened to the Aramaic people? I would like to hear this from an Indian and not only from the Jewish sources who can have it.
Yeah, they can hear you.
No, the Jewish sources, as far as I know, the earliest reference that we have is from a 9th century record, where we have attestations of a grant of land to the Syrian Christian Church in Kollam. There we have a few signatures in Hebrew and the names. Actually, it is Judeo-Arabic. The language is Arabic, the script is Hebrew. Now, this is the way in which we have the document. Then we have another document from the end of the 10th century where we have a whole grant given to a Jewish chief, Joseph Rabban. This is a very, very famous document, but there isn't any Hebrew or there isn't any first person statement obtaining in the Hebrew language or in the Arabic, Judeo-Arabic kind of expression. So the way in which the Jews perceived it, the Jews looked at this land of Malabar or Kerala, or it's very, very difficult to get from these early documents. in the later documents that we have from the Geniza of Cairo, for example, the Cairo Geniza has a few documents about a couple of towns in Kerala, such as Kollam or Madai. But even there, a view of the whole of Malabar or Kerala is wanting there. In the case of Abraham Ben Yehu, for example, who has left behind a large number of documents, again in the Cairo Geniza, we have accounts of the region of Mangalore and the northern part of Kerala, but the whole of Kerala, he doesn't perceive. So given the kind of sources that we have, Jewish sources we have, at the moment it is very difficult for us to form, you know, for example, the way in which the Arab Muslims looked at it or the Portuguese Christians looked at it, that kind of a perception is not available to us.
What about the Aramaic part?
I'm not aware of.
There are some churches with you know, Hebrew script in Aramaic language all over the church, and there are some people still fishing in the backwaters, which says that they come from that and actually speak Aramaic. It's amazing.
I must confess that I haven't made a study of that, and I'm not aware of that.
Terry.
Thanks very much. I wanted to ask if you consider the Parashurama story an act of historiography. Because it, I mean, of course, it has an important role in defining what you call a region, right? It's a very big role, I think, actually. And I mean, actually, while thinking of this question while you were talking, I'm not sure I really know what I mean by historiography, so. But still, I think that kind of carves an important part of the imagination of Kerala. And then I totally follow your conclusion that it seems like Kerala was, you could say, an entity before it became part of a larger whole. But then again, if you take that same story, it's actually coming from that larger whole, right? In a sense, bringing in a story, a kind of Puranic story like this, right? This kind of, it's an act of generating a region within this kind of broader context. Yes.
I'm very much in agreement with this, but we also have to see distinctions. Now, even in the area which believes that this is a land that was created by Parashurama, there is considerable distinction. For example, the coastal region of Karnataka and Kerala, originally this is the land from Gokarna to Kanyakumari. Although this is the original statement there, the Kerala tradition concentrates on the Malayalam-speaking region, and the Kannada Tulu version concentrates on the Kannada Tulu speaking region. There, the distinctions are considerable. The Kerala that you have in the Malayalam version and the South Kannada that you have in the Kannada version, this is entirely different. The land is gifted to the Brahmanas. Then the Brahmanas went back. The Brahmanas get cursed by Parashurama. According to the Kannada version, the Brahmanas get cursed by Parashurama. They become very inferior people. Travesties of Brahmanas. Now that is the word that Brahmana Bhasa, travesties of Brahmana. And then much later, under a Kshatriya king called Mayuravarman, Brahmanas were settled there. So the present day Brahmins of South Kannada have nothing to do with Parashurama. They don't belong there as brought in by Parashurama. On the other hand, in Kerala, the Brahmanas are all descendants of Parashurama. So this continuity is traced, and the reason there, as I have seen, is the control of land that you have in South Kannada is less in Brahmanical hands than in the hands of non-Brahman peasants, the Bant community. On the other hand, in Kerala, much of the land is either Devaswam or Brahmaswam, both controlled by Brahmana. So because of this control of land, you have to seek a kind of validation, a kind of legitimacy by appeal to the divine sanction, divine donation, which is not necessary in the case of South Canada. Going further north to the Konkan coast, for example, the coastal region of Maharashtra, or further north again in the Saurashtra coast, we do have the Parashurama tradition, but again in a very, very different way. So although we say that the entire western coast, western seaboard, starting from, say, Gujarat to Kanyakumari, you have the Parashurama tradition. In each case, it's a different Parashurama. It's a different Parashurama. Of course, one of the avatars of Vishnu. But then the Parashurama of Kerala is different from the Parashurama of Karnataka, the Parashurama of Maharashtra, the Parashurama of Gujarat. And speaking about the rest of India, for example, in Orissa, you have a very strong Parashurama tradition. But Parashurama is not responsible for the creation of land. Parashurama is not responsible for the donation of land. So, although there is this common strand, there are specificities that we have to see there.
Hen, you wanted to?
Actually, you already answered most of my question by answering the previous one. First, thank you very much, sir. I just wanted to, if you can add more to the comparison, for example, to Karnataka. So you already did as far as your second part, the historiography, the text. So maybe just add a little bit as for the first part to mark the distinctions as, for example, for Karnataka. Thank you.
Even here, I must make a distinction within Karnataka. We have to make a distinction between coastal Karnataka on the one side and Karnataka on the other side of the Western Ghats. That is, the Mysore State, or what was part of the Bombay Presidency in Dharwad, what was part of the Hyderabad State. So although today it is Karnataka State, culturally, historiographically, these are entirely different. Now, in these regions of Karnataka, up the Ghats, in the Mysore state or in the Hyderabad state or in the Bombay Presidency, the Parashurama tradition does not obtain at all. The Parashurama tradition is confined to the western coast, the coastal districts of Karnataka, the present-day district of Dakshina Kannada, Udupi, and North Kannada, that is, Uttarakannada, only in these three districts. Here, the master narrative is contained in a Kannada text called Gramapadhati. Gramapadhati, where we have the story of the donation, the creation of the land by Parashurama, the donation of this to Brahmanas. Then the Brahmanas were assured by Parashurama that if you have any need, you can together call, you can call me and I'll be there. These people weren't sure, will he be really here? So one day after they had a very, very good meal, they all joined together and summoned Parashurama. Parashurama came there, asked, we just wanted to know whether you will come. Parashurama was furious, cursed them, said that you will not be any more Brahmana. You will be like the lowest caste of people and you will go about begging. So this is how that land became devoid of any Brahmins. Abrahmanya is the word that is used. Devoid of any Brahmins for a long time. Then under the rule of one of those uncivilized people, Hubashika, the land was suffering. Then a Kadamba king from, again, outside the South Canberra area conquered this region and found that this is a land devoid of Brahmana, so we cannot perform sacrifices here. So he went and invited Brahmanas and settled there. So the present-day Brahmanas of Karnataka owe their existence there, coastal Karnataka, owe their existence to this Kadamba king, not to Parashurama.
I think we'll take two more questions and then conclude. Shalva and Yigal. Shalva, please.
It was a joy to have a lecture on Kerala in Jerusalem. You didn't mention Cranganore, and until 1341, that was an important city. So I wondered how it fitted in with the entity of Kerala. Then I have a few other questions. You mentioned matrilineal system of the Brahmins, and of course we have a survival of that today with the Naya Brahmins. But originally, were all the Brahmins in Kerala matrilineal, and then exactly? So I would like to know how many, or I know you're not a statistician, but a sort of percentage, or how many of the Brahmins were matrilineal, because we have this fascinating example which remains with us. The other question, I've got two more points, short ones. Of course, you're not a modern historian, but I'm curious to know whether the Dutch, who then conquered the area, and then the British, did they take this narrative of Kerala as an entity, lock, stock and barrel? They just inherited this idea? That's the third question. And the fourth point is just a point that the Syrian Christians, of course, prayed and pray, and this is to you, sir, in Syriac, which is very, very similar to Aramaic. And actually, I've written a comparison in Contributions to Indian Sociology, a comparison between the Jews of Cochin and the Canaanite Christians who spoke and speak Syriac, i.e. Aramaic. Thank you.
Now, the first question about Cranganore. Cranganore is actually Cranganore or Rap, as it is actually the Malayalam way in which it is spelled is Kodungallur, which is anglicized into Cranganore. Kodungallur was actually the place called Mahodeyapuram, which I was speaking about, as the capital of the Chera kingdom. Mahodeyapuram is the same place. And in 1341, there was a massive flood, which closed down the port of Kodungallur, and that was rendered literally high and dry following this flood because of silting. That is one of the reasons why Kodungallur lost out in importance as a trading center, and going to Kochi in the south and Kozhikode in the north, Kerala gets other centers of trade. So trade part of it comes from there. The second question about the matrilineal system among the Brahmanas. The story is that Parashurama asked all these Brahmanas to follow matrilineal system, but only those in one particular settlement, one particular village called Payyanur obliged. That is, now this would be to the north you have Chirotur, that is the area where you have the grama or settlement of Payyanur. The Brahmanas of that region, even today, follow the matrilineal system. The others do not, because they did not accept. They did not accept the matrilineal system. The third question about the attitude towards Keralalpatti in the Dutch and the British writings, openly they reject it. Now I can quote from William Logan, who wrote the first serious history of Malabar in his Malabar Manual. He says that this is a farrago of legendary nonsense. Now that is how Logan writes this. But although Logan rejects it, when he writes the history of Kerala in the Malabar Manual, he follows much of the narratives there about the Cheraman Perumal, about the partition of the land by Cheraman Perumal, and the fragmentation of the polity into a large number of smaller entities. then about Syriac as the language of a religious rite in the Syrian years until 1599, when the Portuguese, under the leadership of Portuguese, there was a grand synod in a church near Cochin, in a place called Udaimperu or Diamper, as in European documents it is described as Diamper. In the synod of Diamper, there was an attempt to iron out the differences between the Syrian Christians and the Catholics, Roman Catholics, and there was an attempt to transform these St. Thomas Christians or Syrian Christians into the Roman Catholic Church. The operation did not quite succeed, but the patient did not die either. Now, this is the way in which, and that is why you have all sorts of, in fact, you have a larger number of different sects of Christians in Kerala than perhaps you have in other parts of the world. This is the reason. And Syriac comes from there. But the early documents that we have is entirely about the Syrian Christians. The document that I was talking to about, where we have the Judeo-Arabic attestation, that is about the Syrian Christian church.
One final question, Igal, please.
Thank you for this wonderful talk. I wanted to ask you comparatively. You've been describing a region that has been very stable in many respects. The notion of what we now call Kerala is formed very early on and somehow survived various political formations and religious outlooks and it was pretty stable. I mean, what it is a region of may have changed, but what constitutes the region itself seemed rather stable. Do you think that this, to what extent do you think that this is generalizable to other regions in South Asia or at least in South India?
Perhaps it may not be generalizable. I do not know if that expression is correct. It may not be generalizable. Now, even in the case of Kerala, in the earlier documents, that is documents prior to the 9th century, we don't have the notion of this region at all. At that time, we had the Chera kingdom, which covered two or three districts of Kerala, this Thrissur, Malappuram, Palakkad districts of Kerala, and then extending to Tamil Nadu, Coimbatore, Salem, Erode. So that is the Chera kingdom that we have in the earlier period. So you have that region which disintegrates, and this region takes shape by about the 9th century, 10th century. But after that takes place, this identity gets congealed. What happens is, because of the same language that is being spoken in this territory, because of the similar social and cultural institutions, because of the similar economic relations, you know, the identity gets more and more strengthened, so much so that in the discourse of not only the Brahmanical groups who were responsible in the beginning, but even entirely different groups such as the Muslim scholars or even a foreigner like Barbosa and others who came after him, such as Wartheimer or Lynn Schotter, we find this kind of a thing. So the stability, I should believe, lies beyond the discourse in the social, economic, political factors, then language, culture, etc. This kind of an identity we don't find in many other regions. And because of that, we don't find stability also.
So, I have various questions of my own, but I'm going to have an opportunity, I think, to ask Kesavan over the next few days. You can see the beauty of spending an evening talking about Kerala at the Academy. You can see it by the fact that we have exceeded the Academy's usually very strict rule about limiting questions to about 5 minutes. And I think we could have gone on speaking a lot longer tonight. I want to thank Kesavan Veluthat for coming and giving us this lovely lecture. Thank you very much. Namaskar.